This is first date experience.
Oh, first date. Oh, gosh.
I'm the only single one here, so how are we doing this?
We had a flashback. Believe it or not, we had lives before we met each other.
We sure did.
We don't want to.
I don't believe it.
Somehow.
I don't believe it.
We only 4 years in.
Back in the day, I met someone on one of those dating apps. Right? Boom.
Here are those photos, right?
Ooh. See the photos? All right, cool. We're going to go forward with this. We talking, chopping it up for a while. Decide to finally go on a date, right? Mm-hmm. I go to the bar, waiting for her to get there.
Which bar?
She's like, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. There's trauma attached to this.
Trauma.
We don't want to talk about the bar.
Okay.
We go to I go to the bar and wait for her to come in. This is about to be bad, y'all. Just letting y'all know.
Okay.
She's like, all right, I'm getting out of my Uber now. I'm like, cool. Walking through the door is a paraplegic chick.
Wait.
It was her.
No, she's not walking if she's paraplegic.
Coming through the door.
She's in a wheelchair? She didn't tell you.
She's paraplegic.
Wait.
She couldn't even pick up her. She couldn't even hold her own drink. Like, she was like, her photos. You would not be able to tell. She said nothing about that in her profile. She said nothing about that as we spoke.
Wait, notice what? How quiet we both are. I was like, I'm trying to just.
I'm not making this up. This is a true story.
I don't know what he said. He said a couple of things. He said the chicken heads be quiet.
Oh, and guess what? We were all like, woo!
Hey, listen, whatever they said, whatever he was saying, man. Listen, man, rest in peace, Fat Man Scoop, man. Rest in peace, Fat Man Scoop.
We don't know how many parties he dealt. He let us through several parties.
How many DJs has Fat Man Scoop saved?
Yes.
When it wasn't going so great.
Yeah.
Throwing on and it goes up.
Yes.
Because a party ain't a party. To it ran all through.
Hello.
Come on, Fat Man.
Wow. 53 years young.
Yeah.
Rest in peace.
Rest in peace.
Way too young.
We don't want to. No, this, and that's the thing. Like, we don't like to start the pod off on somber notes, but it's Fat Man Scoop. It's a celebration.
Hey.
You know what I mean? It's
all the party songs.
Shout out to Fat Man Scoop once again.
Yes.
Oh, man. Here we are. Should I just introduce the pod?
We're going to do the number one.
I'm going to introduce and then we'll check in and see how you're doing.
Okay, let's do it.
Welcome to episode 72 of the Where's Brunch podcast.
Hey. The glamorous life. Ooh.
This is when I get to sit back.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, listeners, viewers, close and far, to the Where's Brunch podcast. I am your co-host, Trine Marie.
Oh, I'm Brocky, like the Black Rocky.
And we have a fantastic special guest in the house today, the Rosé Hour podcast.
Shout out to Renee, y'all, you know what I'm
saying? Hey, Renee.
Hey, y'all got me to cross the bridge.
Yes.
She feels like she's in South Carolina right now. Yes. Going to Alexandria, Virginia from D.C.
I made it to Italy. It's wonderful there. Thank you.
Four scorns and several moons ago.
I woke up at 5 a.m. to make it. I took a train, two planes, did a triathlon to get here,
so
but I'm here.
Dramatic. Oh, so dramatic. Oh, my goodness. Our sister pod, welcome to the show, yo.
Yes, welcome.
We're family.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. We welcome you here to this magnificent Where's Brunch podcast. And we're coming off the heels of brunch.
Mm.
We had brunch, y'all, and we had drinks.
A brunch was had.
We pre-podded.
Yeah, we pre-podded. Yo, how many times I had to stop y'all? Wasted good material.
I mean, we could run it back. I mean,
you know, some of those things are gonna come back up.
Yes, they are. Yes, they are.
That's the thing about me. If I don't take notes, it's gone. I'm almost 50. You know what I mean? So I don't remember what we're talking about.
Welcome.
Did you do all the Spotify and all that stuff? You did that already?
Oh yes, to the listeners. Thank you. On your all your streaming platforms, your Apple, iPod, your podcast. I don't know.
Rewind.
Run that back.
Okay. Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Amazon Podcasts, and all the other
YouTube.
Yes. If you're viewing, you can also look at us
and
today.
You can listen on YouTube now.
And you can also listen on YouTube now. And then you can also catch our shorts, be it on TikTok, Instagram, and Facebook as Where's Brunch Podcast. Mm-hmm. We are there. So please like, follow, subscribe, comment, and also like, comment, share, and follow the Rosé Hour podcast.
Hey, it's also at Rosé Hour podcast.
At Rosé Hour podcast. Yes.
A lot of horns involved today.
Hey, I am like 2.5 mimosas in.
Oh, so I'm feeling good. When people start saying 0.5 instead of 2.5, like 0.5, you know it's going to be a problem.
Because it's that half.
It's that 0.5 that's
taking you over.
That's what we blame it on, the half?
Yeah, it's the half. Blame it on
the goose, blame it on the, you know.
Yeah.
Or your levels could have been at half and 2 took you over.
That 0.2.
But you know, this is mimosa. I mean, but it's Chadwick's mimosas. Their mimosas are heavy, very light-skinned.
They
were very Southern Mississippi light skin, paper bag tested.
Those AKA mimosas.
They were definitely tested. They were Louisiana Creole.
Delicious, y'all.
Yeah.
Yo, how's everybody? Trina, how you doing, man? You good?
I'm feeling warm and fuzzy.
Okay, that's a good thing. Y'all, this is about to be a shit show. Just letting y'all know right now, if you only listen typically to like 3.5, 4, 5 minutes, 8 minutes of them, you might want to stick around because this is going to get ridiculous. Renee, what's good? How are you?
So while Trina is 2.5 mimosas in, I am 1.5, but I haven't been drinking in a while. So that 1.5 I'm on is like, mm-hmm. 6 right now.
Listen, okay.
So yeah.
How are you doing?
I'm chilling.
You're the sober rober here.
I'm pretty sober. I'm pretty sober
for now,
is not to my liking because my back has been giving me a lot of issues lately. Mm. I got a massage today, a Thai massage, which is fantastic. The rest of my body is super happy. Okay. But my lower right side right now,
your back.
It's basically like Iraq versus whoever
on
lower right side of my back right
now. That's crazy. Cause
I can't, it only hurts when I breathe, don't breathe, get up, sit down, move or don't move. So other than that, I'm good.
Existence.
Yo,
so when you're awake.
Cheers, y'all. Yeah. Cheers.
Oh, yes. Cheers.
Cheers. Cheers. Cheers. Cheers. Cheers. Yeah. Oh, y'all did a lot of stretching to tap.
All right. Because it was meant to be.
So we have a little Mum Napa Rosé here for us to sip on following the mimosas that we've already got in today. So get ready, ladies and gentlemen. Buckle up. Put your seatbelt on and get ready for the wild ride.
With the calm voice. It's such a distrusting voice. When you're talking so calm like that, talking about the ruckus. So look, typically... This is our second time having the guest, right? Yes. Joe was on the first time. But we do like to go have brunch first and then come pod, which is a fun time.
Pre-podding,
you know what I'm saying?
Pre-gaming.
And I'm going to say something right now, and I hope that everybody in the room is cool with it.
Oh, Lord.
Right? But I'm going
to
tell you.
If you ever have to give a disclaimer.
I have to give a disclaimer. Okay. I have to give a disclaimer right now.
Oh, God.
All right, so folks out there,
here comes the
I'm telling you right now
here comes the
that you haven't had brunch like the brunch that I've had today when you hear two big-tittied women talking at brunch. They are crazy. I acted like I wasn't paying attention, but I was.
I'm sorry, Beans. I had to holler. I just had to
y'all
holler.
Y'all are nuts.
Beans was looking at us like, wait, what did I miss?
What'd he say? Y'all, I have anything to say about this? I was sitting right there being completely disregarded the entire time.
Babe, I'm sorry.
So no, don't be sorry. Okay. It's great pod material. Please, someone speak up.
Okay, so I volunteer as tribute.
Okay.
So, as a member of the Big Titty Committee,
yeah.
sometimes you have to have conversations with your fellow committee members.
Amen.
And time and place don't matter.
Hallelujah.
You have to have the conversation because it's key to moments that are further in life. And so we needed to have an executive member meeting.
Absolutely.
And we did not care who children were around as well.
Husbands.
Amen.
And we did not care whose husbands, children, servers, who was around, did not matter. Because the meeting needed to take place.
Absolutely.
And
it's important.
We needed to also show examples.
The hand signaling and like sign languaging. Are those official sign language postures and gestures you guys were making?
It's the unspoken understanding.
Because
yes,
there may have been another woman who was an executive member of the committee in proximity.
She knew exactly what y'all was talking about.
May have needed to come into the conversation.
That makes sense.
Yes. To have additive, you know, points.
Yes.
Absolutely.
So we just were making sure everyone was clear.
That makes
absolutely
sense.
Absolutely.
In what we were discussing.
You know, because it's all about serving the greater good.
Yeah. Serving the greater good.
And service we have to help. All.
We have to help everyone out there. Everyone needs to know about the deals, the discounts, the sales, the subscription packages.
The buckle positioning, the under sweat, the back fat.
The under boob sweat.
The what time of the day do you wear, evening, nighttime, what you should be doing, the raw dogging.
And where you let them run free.
Let them be free.
Run free.
You gotta let them things hang.
Oh my God. What has happened?
Let them things hang.
What has
so
happened?
That happened at brunch, and I'm sorry, baby.
Don't you're be sorry. It's, you know, you're not, listen, man. Listen.
I know you're used to it. I have no filter.
That's all good.
Yeah. I have zero filter. I will talk about anything.
If you have no filter.
Yes.
Then that means Renee traded her filter in 20 years ago for a diamond ring or something.
I have
a
filter.
Necklace.
I have a filter. It's just modified. It's modified.
Mm-hmm.
And also, I like to use a megaphone because I like to amplify the message. So that's it. I'm a messenger.
Listen, these foundations out here are not cheap.
Yes.
These foundations are important to the look of our garment.
Hold on. What do you mean foundations, babe? What do you mean?
Foundations. That's what a brassiere is called.
Yes.
Oh.
It's a foundation.
And it's a brassiere.
And it's a brassiere as well.
Hallelujah.
A foundation? I never heard
yes,
that.
Yes, you never heard the word foundation? That's something from grandmas and aunties.
Come
and
on
stuff.
Now. She's
you
got
to have
gospel.
a proper foundation.
Yes.
It's the basis of your outfit. The foundation of your outfit is your brassiere.
Fellas, y'all listening? Go into your wife's drawer, sneak, get her little bra size, and wish for the best. Because if you order from somewhere, it might not fit the same.
And depending on the season, it may not be.
Yep, it might. Yeah. Summer versus winter bras might not be the same.
And also, we discussed summertime. Let them things hang.
Let them hang. Get your nipple covers and just be free.
And also,
I don't believe in that.
You don't believe in nipple covers?
Let them things hang.
Listen, I got to cover the nipples because I don't need everybody we have
contrasting viewpoints on no bra summers.
I believe, like no shave November, right, yeah. for men.
Yeah.
No bra summers for women. And why am I covering? Who am I covering this for?
Because everybody don't need to see my areola. They don't need to see.
Wait a minute, baby. You talking about going braless or going topless? Boy,
but you can see it through the. If you got a large. It
depends on the top, right?
If you got a large areola and large nipple space.
Not saying that that's what she has. I'm just saying, y'all relax.
I'm just saying that if you know that you have a large circumference of space being presented, I don't need everybody to know the width and circumference and diameter of my nipple.
I don't care. It is seasonal.
I got you.
Y'all getting some seasonal areolas out there?
It is only for three months.
The no bra movement has increased exponentially in the past three or four years?
Any day you see everybody's, they sway left, right, up, and down. You just walk down the street and you see everybody's business.
I will go ahead and lift a fist to my fellow sisters. When I see it, I'll be like,
I'm still a little conservative on that side. No. I'm not quite ready, but shout out to Kim Kardashian and all the Skims like wear that sucks it in. So it's not exactly the jiggle and the wiggle, so that if you are braless, you can still have the foundational support.
I let it wiggle.
I don't want it to wiggle. I'm anti-wiggle.
I can dig it, man. We started the pod off with a very strong topic.
Right.
Very strong topic.
I feel like this is like what the presidential debate should look like. Should you let it wiggle? Should you let it hang?
You will find out if Kamala's fake or not, depending on how she answers those questions.
Oh my gosh.
Should she be president?
Should you be president?
Will you let it wiggle, ma'am?
But that's a great question for the viewers. Do you let them hang and let them wiggle? Or are you with a foundation? Do you need a bra at all times?
In the winter, I'm down with it.
Shout out to Michael Jackson, y'all.
Let it go.
Happy birthday.
Hey, happy birthday.
Yes, Michael.
Happy birthday. Y'all.
How old would he have been this year?
Oh, shoot. That's a good question. You might want to look that up.
I'm looking it up right now.
Okay, man. Ooh, PYT. Where did you come from, baby? And ooh, won't you take me there? By the way, well, don't be late.
Hey.
Man, we talked about tenderoni. Pause it. We talked about tenderoni.
Go.
We asked, did Michael Jackson create the word tenderoni?
We did.
Didn't we talk about that?
Can anyone point out a time before PYT that someone said the term
tenderoni?
Boom.
Did anybody else?
He would be 65 today.
He would have been
65. Wow.
Damn.
Tenderoni.
Body roll. Hey.
Mike used to the back, step back, body roll.
Shout out to Mike, man.
Do it.
The goats.
Yes.
65?
Man, gone 65. Too soon. Could you imagine Mike out spinning, doing like the James Brown stuff at 65, hitting the Thriller and the Billie Jean?
I feel like he would have been doing it still.
And to beat it?
I just want to know what his hair would have looked like.
Oh, yes.
He would have had a crazy lace front.
Because he was wearing lace fronts before.
Before lace fronts.
Lace fronts. Mm-hmm,
they were flawless.
Oh.
You couldn't see no scalp issues. It looked like he grew that hair.
Yo, when do black people have to let go of the sentence? Rest in peace, blank. He would have been blank today.
I don't know.
You see people on Facebook like, he would have been, you know, 98 today. I'm like,
if he was still alive.
But 98 is not, it's not easy to achieve.
That's true.
But I mean, they, people do it in other cultures, like Elvis Presley. They do that for the rock and roll king would have been 199.
Come on, son. No, he wouldn't have.
He still would have been jailhouse rocking.
But 65, he would have still been spinning, and he probably would have had a stage. He would have had a concert happening right
I'm
now.
I'm all for 65. I'm
he would have had a birthday bash.
He would have. Michael Jackson would have been on tour if he was alive right now.
Right?
Okay. He would have been in China right now, Tokyo.
People screaming. People fainting. Right. Passing out all over the place. And a new movie would have been coming out about him.
Another shout out. Quick shout out to Nelly and Ashanti. They, Ashanti gave birth.
Congratulations.
Well, four weeks ago or something like that. Five weeks ago.
Little baby. Yay. Little baby boy. I forgot. I saw the name.
St. Louis. I'm making that up.
No.
Yeah, that was pretty good. I actually believe so. She said that. St. Louis.
No, that wasn't the name. I forgot. Yeah. Ashanti did say the name of the baby, but congratulations to them.
Shout out to them.
And you know, the healing of the mother and lack of pressure for the immediate snapbacks. Everybody is not going to snap back.
Yeah, she did post those photos.
To a size zero, especially if you're having a baby over 40. No. Right. You're not going to snap back like that.
Why niggas always catching charges around the time their kid's born, though?
Listen, Nelly, get your life. Get some insurance.
Dang. Come on, Nelly.
Get some car insurance.
What else we got?
Jake with State Farm is everywhere. The Gecko is everywhere for Geico. There's all these people. Allstate. What's the dude from Allstate?
Is that Mayhem?
Mayhem. Yeah. They got all these options. Nelly, please get you some car insurance.
They be trying to set us up, yo. What else going on, man? Everybody had a good week, though?
Anything what did I
exciting
do this
week? Anything?
Let me think.
We went to see Buju this week.
Buju
Banton this week.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying?
And my legs and my buttocks hurt after the concert.
And here's the topic. The topic is not Buju, ladies and gentlemen.
I'm very intrigued to know what this topic is.
Listen. We stood up the whole show.
But you had seats.
We had seats.
We were not in the pit. But there was a pit with standing room only people that I don't even understand how they did that.
Okay.
There's no way.
But you all had seats.
We had seats.
So let's stood.
Yeah.
And we stood.
The whole place sat up.
You couldn't help but not to stand up.
Okay, okay. I feel the vibe. So I'm waiting for the topic.
I have a Trinidadian friend.
Okay.
Yes.
Right? He is out of my two Trinidadian friends.
Yes.
Are the only two in the crew who still go out.
Yes.
They are in committed relationships. All that stuff. They're not running the street. They are just Trinidadian and have to be among the culture and the music at all times. We're at the show. We're all watching the show, all of us for a long time. It's like, eight of us? Six of us? Six of us. Watching the show. Everybody having a great time. Buju is killing it. Towards the end of the show, you know, it went a different route. He had the Maroons come out. Some Congos and all this other stuff. Whatever, right? So it was dope. Five of us sat down. My Trinidadian friend at the end looked at us in disgust like, what are y'all doing?
But wait, before it started, you know what he said to me? He said, I need a wall to go stand up against.
Well,
yeah. While this is happening. That's definitely cultural. Yeah.
So I'll be 50 in March. I don't know about y'all niggas.
Wait, go ahead and hit that little pew, 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 pew.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's huge.
Catch me in Egypt.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And
you riding camels. Yeah, I love it.
I'll be at home and going to bed.
Okay.
And if my best guess is that this young lady next to me, she's with me.
Yes.
So we were dying the next day after that Buju show.
My goodness. My body was like, what are you thinking? How old are you? This is not 1995 Howard University CSA party. No, you are 48 years old.
Act like it.
Please act accordingly.
Renee, where do you stand?
I stand on, There was not proper preparation. There was not proper preparation.
What we gotta do, stretch?
Yeah, well, I think y'all raw dogged the night, right? Like, y'all were like, oh, I love just going that. To a concert, you know. I don't think you guys really fully researched the situation you were about to be in.
But right? I wore sneakers. I didn't wear heels.
I feel like you guys did not take a nap, right? One. Oh, I think no, you didn't stretch. I don't think you mentally were prepared to stand.
That's right. The thing. I wasn't tired or anything of that nature until the next day.
Yeah. So it's a mental thing too. Like, mm-hmm. here's your body like, okay, 20 minutes, mm-hmm. 30 minutes. Mm-hmm. It's like The Simpsons. And then like, you know, Marge's hair like starts falling after an hour, you know? And so I feel like you guys went into it and you were like, we did not sign up for all of this.
It was a good time though.
It was a great time though. It was, the energy was amazing. You know, as a person who's grown up Caribbean adjacent.
same.
It was so much fun to just see everybody, just the flags waving, the screaming, the yelling, and to look at how limber Buju still is at whatever age he is right now. Because he did like a full drop squat and just hung there and just,
and you had the nerve to turn to me and ask me about, yo, you about to drop it down?
I said, my husband, I need to ask him.
If I go down there, I'm not coming back.
Yeah, he did.
I'm not coming back.
Well, and here we are today with you having a back issue.
Because the way that he, Buju just got to the edge of the stage and dropped and just hung there with the mic. And I was like,
but he's also a performer.
He's a performer.
And this is what he does.
Babe, can you do that? Babe, can you do that?
Somebody pay me?
Babe, can you do that?
For money, yes.
If he's being trained for like 6 months and then he goes on tour, I'm pretty sure, you know, a lot of us will do this.
All I know is there's a lot of ginseng and whatever else going on. And
ginseng. What do you think Buju was doing all those years in prison? Stretching.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? I've been over here watching Fresh Prince of Bel-Air and shit.
Do you think Buju has now elevated to the level of Bob Marley?
No. Okay. And it's kind of like the Michael Jordan conversation, because there's so many things that go into Bob Marley being elevated to that position outside of music.
Right. Political consciousness.
That Buju wasn't able to accomplish because of his path was his path. You know what I mean? He went to prison and shit. Like,
but do you,
he was a dance hall artist first.
Okay. But don't you think like
he's there. He's up there, yo.
He's the political consciousness, talking about the Maroons, talking about the needs for the people and all that stuff.
Buju was talking to his base.
Okay.
Bob was talking to everybody.
Yeah, this is true.
You know what I'm saying? So I thought about this. That's great. Yo. I thought about like, damn, how high has Buju Banton elevated? And I don't think he'll ever reach that level just because of the climate and where we are in the world today.
Okay.
And people are just now finding out about him.
A lot of people and that's the thing. Like,
which is crazy.
His people know him. And whatnot, but outside of that, you don't know. You know what I'm saying? You don't.
Is
no one knows
Buju Banton. The imprisonment thing?
No. That's just because he was a dancehall artist first, and dancehall is a very specific genre of music. And we follow him, and then we follow him into the roots, spiritual stuff, and whatnot. We went with him, but he never made it to like a broad platform. Okay, people don't know Buju Banton.
So
like
this is more about growing up Caribbean adjacent.
Maybe. Mm-hmm. Maybe.
Okay.
What do you mean though? What do you mean by that?
Like I mean, because for us, there are just artists that we know about. Like, we know about Buju. We know about Beeman. We know about Barris Hammond. We know about, let me think of somebody else. I know Red Rat.
You know who Stone Love is?
Yes, Stone Love. Right, so I've been to a bunch of Stone Love concerts when I was in college.
Renee, are you familiar with Stone Love?
Yeah.
All right, so Stone Love, you know how popular they are, right?
Yes.
Joe, the Trinidadian friend I was just talking about, his cousin in Trinidad didn't know who Stone Love was.
Really?
Yeah.
Because Trinidad is not reggae music. Trinidad is soca. You know what I'm saying? Then you got the calypso stuff, I believe.
Yeah, but like, and also the Caribbean is so different in different genres.
Yes,
right?
That's right.
Right? Because you have the Afro-Caribbean, right? And that is a whole nother mix of music, right?
Yeah.
So, and each island has their own type of reggae as well, because there's reggaeton.
The reggaeton.
And there's dancehall, right? Mm-hmm. So then it's just so different.
Wow.
And they have their own culture.
Yeah.
That's wild. didn't know who Stone Love was. Again, Caribbean adjacent. My friends from my childhood were Bahamian, Jamaican, in my neighborhood. I'm just thinking Bahamian, all Jamaican, Bermudan. Like, those are the people in my neighborhood that I grew up with. So, yeah.
Okay. This is crazy. I'm just like,
it's a production.
Yeah.
But do you see, I'm like, part of me is also like in shock and like proud moment of like, as you guys are like family, like, this is insane. Like, I'm so happy for you all.
Appreciate
Thank
that,
you.
Yo.
I just feel like this is the norm. I don't know what else there, like, there was a moment where it just like changed and everything upgraded. And I was like, okay.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. When we started off with just one camera.
Yeah.
No, that one actually. Yeah. Then I bought that one. Then I bought that one. Yeah, I mean, changed. You know, just piece things together. It changed. You learn, had other lighting before. Then I got these lights.
Bougie lights.
Like, yeah. You know what I'm saying? And like, I'm still like one light down. Like, well, I need another light.
I'm a deer in headlight. Like,
yeah, you silly, yo.
I'm what?
You silly, yo.
I'm definitely like starstruck.
No. So guys.
Yes. Bring us
previously, up we talked on a podcast about people getting deals in podcasting, right? Multi-million dollars. Call Her Daddy podcast got $125 million through Sirius Radio.
I got to rub my eye real hard.
Trina said, are the black people getting, Trina X said, are the black pals getting any money? And I was like, well, you know, Gillian Wallow and them, Drink Champs, you know, I took the safe route, but it turns out Trina might have been onto something, like most black people when they're pointing out bullshit in this country. Let me see if I can get into this.
Cause I'm black, y'all. Cause I'm black, y'all. Cause I'm black, y'all.
Open this link up.
Trina X, her dashiki in her head wrap. She be knowing.
Celebrity podcasters keep getting $100 million deals.
Celebrity.
LOL. All right, so let's see. Who got deals?
Travis Kelce and his brother.
The Kelce brothers got $100 million.
They two already football NFL players. One with multiple NFL championship Super Bowl rings.
And he got Taylor Swift money.
Yeah, like, come on.
Are they podcasters?
No, they're athletes.
They're just athletes. 100 million. Smart Less, hosted by actors Jason Bateman, who we love.
Yes.
Sean Hayes and Will Arnett.
I have actually listened to that podcast because it was sent to me. There was an episode that everyone thought that I could relate to, and I listened to it.
100 million.
Yes.
Alex Cooper, who is called her daddy, $125 million.
Still trying to figure out.
Conan O'Brien,
who's off TV,
$150 million deal with Sirius XM. Joe Rogan, as we all know, $250 million already.
Problematic racist.
And Bill Simmons, $250 million. The one thing that all these folks have in common is
they're of the Caucasian persuasion.
They're white. So, what is the discussion? There's a few points here.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah. Yeah. So they're on one side, of course, it's a good thing to see podcasters getting deals again, because that tells us that there's money out there for podcasters. Mm-hmm. Right. But then you get the wall that we all, as black folks, have to acknowledge in today's society. And on the other side of that wall is a bunch of white folks getting deals. Anybody?
I'll yield to the guests first. Before I go all in.
I would just say that I'm just over it. In this whole, like, people want to act like equity and parity and making sure that there's inclusion. There's not. We give excuses of saying this, and then we do things like this. And say, oh, well, they do a good job at this. And it's like, well, no, we're creating situations to elevate people based upon relativeness of celebrities who actually are mediocre. Because what are they really talking about?
Right.
What is their real connectedness? Like, they're not really excelling at anything great. Their conversation isn't really, like, moving any needles. It's not really amplifying anything. It's not really changing anything in the world or anyone's life or impacting anything that's going on. It's mediocrity at its best. And we reward it. But that's what we always do. And then here we are having real people of color, especially Black podcasters, who are really doing hard work, who are really doing things in the world, who are impacting others. And we're like, oh, well, try harder. Mm. Mm.
So what do we say to someone who says, well, the population of the U.S., Black people only take up 11%, right? Mm. And then the white people take up, what, 80-something percent?
But right? Minorities take up pretty much almost the majority and will be the majority mm-hmm. shortly. Yeah. Right and about so, that. So if we look at it from that lens, the majority life experience, I rather amplify versus a minority, which will be white people. Mm. Yes, we want to hear everybody's experience, and everybody's experience matters. And I'm not giving the All Lives Matter response here, but I want to make sure that we're amplifying those that we are not hearing from. Mm-hmm. Why are we not amplifying those stories? Because those stories matter the most, because those are the most common stories, because those are the majority of people that we see on this planet. Mm.
Yeah. And I would say also along those lines, in the spirit of corporate wokeness and corporate capitalism and awareness, when George Floyd's situation came out, organizations, major corporations were made aware of their lack of diversity. They were made aware of their lack of representation. They were made aware of how they weren't including minorities in the conversations and the representations for their brands. Mm-hmm. So here we are 4 years later after George Floyd, where everyone was doing the black squares and everyone wanted to know how they could be more involved, and we're back to safety. Mm. We're back to convenience, and we're back to representation that doesn't reflect the full United States.
Yeah.
We have them just corporations only picking the folks that look like and represent them. Mm-hmm. That's where we are, because corporate wokeness is a problem. As we've learned in politics, they all want to get away from being too woke and aware. So they don't want to look at black and brown people. I mean, you
see, everybody got rid of their DEI programs. As soon as the law was gone.
I mean, heck, they're saying our vice president is a DEI vice president. So there's a lot, and you can't have it both ways. You can't be all aware in 2020 and then all of a sudden now it's 2024 and you're looking the other way and only focused. It's very clear. The Amazons, the iHeartRadios, the Spotify. If you have this money and you're giving this money primarily to Caucasian voices, where's the money for the black voices? And don't try to cut it down to 10 million or 4 million or 3 million mm-hmm. because they're black voices. Because as you looked at the numbers for urban media and revenue, when you look at the Joe Buttons, when you look at the Breakfast Club, when you look at Wallow and Gilly, and you mm-hmm. look at Cam and Mace, and you look at
Drink Champs.
The numbers are there.
Yeah, for sure.
The numbers are there.
Huge numbers.
So you can't lowball the black folks because it's safer to go with the white folks. Mm. I told y'all. They just want to pay the white folk. I don't know what to say about it. It's very unfortunate, but it's very clear. And it shows what the United States continues to do.
Yeah.
It's going to be the United States. We're going to continue doing what the United States does best. Mm-hmm.
So what do black creators do in the meantime? Just keep pushing? Keep going? Keep swinging the bat?
Know your worth and add 30%.
I say also create our own. Like, I'm so sick of us, like, keep going and pandering and, oh, we got to go to Amazon and beg for money, and then they give us a little bit.
But do we have the major media brands that can support us and put us out there and get the marketing and get the sponsorship and the ads and stuff like that? That's what we're missing.
No, actually, we have the money, right? Because our money flows out of our community faster than anybody else.
Yeah. It does.
Right?
Let the dollar circulate.
We spend quicker than anybody else. We need to be better strategically as a community and how we flow our dollars.
So where is the media brand other than Byron Allen? who I know is a media mogul who is established and working. I don't know what he's doing in the podcast space. I don't know. I know Will Packer is working on the movie side of things, but where do black...
We go to Tubi. No.
Yes. God damn it, Renee. That's great.
God, Tubi. We do not have a Tubi.
Revolt is on. Is in shambles.
We do not have a Tubi membership in this house, and I don't know if I want to watch. When I see some of them side things on Instagram, I don't know if I want to watch Tubi.
Listen, that's another conversation because I love me some Tubi.
Oh my gosh.
Yes.
The Tubi came with a bag. We can be considering it.
Hey,
that much.
Tubi, we're here.
But no, I think we need to just figure out ways to create our own, right? Because again, right, we created Black Wall Street and it thrived, right? Mm-hmm. Until they burnt it down. We created, you know, Greenwood until they dispersed it, right? Like, okay, we create our own and we do well. We have HBCUs. And guess what? Now, this year alone, HBCUs has seen the most in enrollments.
Applications.
At every HBCU across the country.
HU.
And every PWI, especially like even my own alma mater, Ivy League institution, has seen a substantial decrease in minority applications. Mm-hmm. It's a direct correlation to DEI being removed from corporations.
Absolutely.
And they don't even realize it until it's going to be too late.
It'll be 5 years, 10 years later.
It's going to be 5 to 10 years later. Mm-hmm. And we're seeing it now.
Yeah.
So we got to be strategic with our younger people, our younger generations, and try to figure out where we're going to do with these dollars. How do we invest in them? How do we create our own networks? Yeah. So that we're able to create our own sort of podcast networks of investors.
Yeah.
So that's what we should be doing now.
So Earn Your Leisure's got all these representatives and people and the 50 Cents and the Steve Harvey's and all those
put
folks.
Put your money together.
Let's put the money together.
Yeah.
Put it together.
I challenge them. $10 million. Yeah. That ain't nothing to them.
Right. It's hard
to create something.
It's hard to ask someone who's driving a factor in life is money. To put money into something that's going to help forward the culture in the community.
But if you see the ROI, right? Uh-huh. And if you think about it, right? If you're a business person and you see that it's looked at as an investment and it's strategic, I make this $10 million investment in 2024. Mm-hmm. I'm already seeing how HBCUs, and especially we know what comes out of HBCUs, communication majors. We see doctors, we see lawyers. You put your money into where this is and in these kind of businesses and invest now, 5 to 10 years later, we know that we're going to see professionals coming out, and we're going to have those professionals, that we're going to have the dollars that we're going to be able to have from those investments into workers.
Yes.
So absolutely, that money is already going to be making you more money.
And business owners.
It makes complete sense. And what you said, I'm just reflecting on it. Like, I haven't seen any major black media organization or major black company period announce even a $5 million or $10 million deal with any black, you know what I'm saying, content creator or a podcast or anything like that. We haven't seen that.
I think Byron Allen is probably going to be the closest one to being able to do that because he established
he's official.
If he could do it, and then it probably would spring off into a bunch of folks.
But if he gets like a Robert Smith, if he gets like a John Rogers, he gets like all these huge investors, right, to come in and help him with it, it ain't nothing.
It ain't nothing.
I think Roc Nation is planning. I think they're on their way to doing it. I think because they just started Roc Nation distribution for artists to put their music out. I think that they might be headed in that direction, and we might see that, you know, first, you know, this ain't Joe Budden for this is Where's Brunch Podcast, right?
Hey,
Where's Brunch Podcast, you know what I'm saying? $25 million deal with Roc Nation.
I'll accept
you know what I'm saying? Like, I think that's on
the Rosie Hour podcast, $5
million. You say $5
million? I'll take it.
Just to let y'all know, y'all can lowball us if y'all want to.
I'm just saying, y'all get 25 and y'all pass me 5.
That's hey, right. You know what I'm saying? For real. Sister, right? Yeah. Sister five.
I'll carry y'all purse. I'm just saying. Where we going today, y'all?
Only one of us carries a purse. But I do not carry a purse.
Well, what do you think? But what do you think about the initiatives where Oprah tried it with Harpo?
But With what though? With like producing movies and stuff like that.
Do you think that Oprah, if that's a venue for Oprah to try to jump into, because she's the next other billionaire black person who could possibly do it?
I think she's not in the space anymore.
Yeah, she's kind of let Harpo go.
I think she's on other ventures that are silent. And yeah, again, like, right, she was speaking at the DNC. That's something she's never been political.
Yeah, she's not. She's anti-political.
And yet she spoke at the DNC.
Uh-huh. Right.
Right? Like, that was a huge statement. And I think for her, I think she's taking her money in another way. Because I think she sees something of a different value. So I don't think she's in the comm space anymore.
Gotcha. Here's someone I think could jump into the comm space. Rihanna.
She could. I think
Rihanna could. She could pivot. She could add that to her.
Actually, I think it's. I think with the Rock Nation, Beyonce is the one who's going to do it.
You think
and
so?
I think she's positioning herself to do it.
You think?
She does all these things so silently.
Mm-hmm.
But she's not the only
she
part.
She wouldn't be the face. She would put the money.
Possibly.
And she also has a foundation that will be able to do it.
Because she doesn't have, she's the only media involvement she has right now is music, right? Mm-hmm. She's not involved in any other way. She could do it.
But her foundation would be able to do it.
Maybe so.
But I think if Rihanna was looking for another venture, I mean, she's got this $1 billion makeup industry. She's got the Fenty line.
She's killing it.
If she could just slide on over to that.
Yeah.
Because remember, she went through the whole thing where Instagram kicked her off and banned her and censorship and all that stuff. If she decided to open that little wing, Rihanna, get at me.
Wow.
I'm available.
That's crazy,
Rihanna, I am available.
Shout out to that.
I'm available for consulting.
Shout out to
Shout
out to the potential.
Yes. Yeah. There's tons. I mean, I think Will Packer Studios is doing an amazing job right now.
Yeah.
And I think Will Packer, if he got some more backing to do, because he's helping other black businesses, period, just in general, all across the scene, he's doing stuff. Mm-hmm. If Will Packer got some backing behind him too, he could possibly do it too.
Well, and I think also like people think Tyler Perry, I think Tyler Perry is not set up for that.
Yeah, I think he's done great with the sound, the studio stage and the cinemas and the major filming studio that he has available for people. But I mean, it could be something in his wheel.
Listen, man, if I'm shooting my podcast and out of nowhere, a black man in a dress run across the set, I'm going to be a little upset about that.
If Madea came to be on our podcast, we would accept her.
How much money did they pay us for that again?
I'm just saying,
if Madea came on the Where's Brunch podcast, we would accept her.
Madea goes to brunch.
Madea goes to brunch? Yes, we would accept
her.
How do
I face my friends after that?
Listen, because she
do I get rid of my friends?
She wants to know what's for brunch. She's drinking.
She might come turned up
from brunch already. So coming to the podcast,
I had a topic that I was saving for later, but it has to go. Uh-huh. Right now, and okay. I have a question for both of you guys. Mm-hmm. Let me see if I can find us.
Is Madea eating for brunch?
Nope. Listen,
Madea's bringing her gun
independently, right? Rose Hour podcast or Where's Brunch podcast? Uh-huh. I'll go with you first, Renee.
I don't like this.
Rose Hour podcast. Rose Hour podcast gets a $50 million deal.
Oh shit!
What is the first convo with your best friend, and what is the first difference they will notice about you?
Okay. So Melinda.
We got a name.
Melinda. Looking directly at the camera. Melinda Demery.
Oh no, last name.
I got $50 million. All right. First conversation. She know I got the money?
She know, yeah. This is based off the money.
It's known? Okay.
So she's like, oh, so who calling who?
Hey man, listen. You form the scenario however you want.
All right.
What is that conversation? What are you going to say?
So I got the money, right? All right. And so knowing our friendship is probably a text. And it's probably from her like, and so I'm going to call her and I'm like, go ahead and head to Midway.
There you go. Hey, that's what I'm talking about. Let's go.
And she will know what that means. So Melinda, you know what that means.
So she's known you had the money, right? So y'all meet up at Midway. Mm-hmm. And y'all meet up wherever y'all meeting up, right? Because mm-hmm. it's in Chicago, right? So y'all meet up and she's going to say, you know what? I was wondering because you lately you've been, what would she say?
Oh,
because you got the money.
We boarding a flight. You know where we going? So we boarding the flight. So she know why I was acting funny. Had to move the money real quick.
There you go. So hey,
we about to be out here about. Real quick. We going.
What about you, Trina?
Takia.
Hey, the homie.
First of all, I'm saying meet me in Kingston. We need to find out if Pops's compound is capable of filming podcasts from Kingston.
Oh, wait a minute. I'm going to?
Yeah, you're going to. Oh, shit. We need to find out if Pops's compound, if we can set it up in a way to film podcasts in Stony Hills.
Mm.
And what do we need to do to make that happen?
Mm.
And I'll meet you there.
Mm.
I'll meet you there. That's all we doing. We'll do all the rest of the conversations in person.
So then when she get in person?
Yeah.
And she said, you know, lately, I've been noticing something about you. Lately, you've been, and what would the answer be? Because what would that fill in the blank based off of the money that you had and her noticing the difference in you? What she gonna notice about you first?
You've been in Florida for like 4 months.
You ain't said nothing about your job in a while.
Yeah, I don't think you are employed anymore because you've been in Florida in the ocean for a month straight. You've been in the ocean.
That is hilarious. Yeah, that's fantastic.
Yeah, but Takia would know. We would be in Jamaica trying to figure out how we can shoot the podcast permanently from Kingston in the mountains.
And isn't it kind of funny that we were like to our best friends directly?
Yeah,
we out.
Yeah. Listen, yeah. I guess if I had to say, I had to answer this question, typically don't.
Yeah,
I would say that my friends, because I have like 5 best friends, right? Yeah. I would say, listen, y'all, I got a spot in Miami for this week, and these are the dates. Tickets are taken care of. Everybody meet up. We're gonna have a good time.
Wow.
And they say, well, man, congratulations on the deal, the $50 million. I was wondering, man, because lately, yo ass, and I'll be like, I've been driving around naked in a Lamborghini.
Naked.
That was me.
Naked in a Lamborghini?
That was me.
How'd that work?
That was me.
Did you put a towel down?
That was me. All you need to know.
No further questions from the Rose Hour podcast. We're good.
I know the name of this podcast now. This episode is Naked in a Lamborghini.
Naked in a Lamborghini. Somebody remember that, please.
Naked in a Lamborghini? What?
No further questions, Your Honor. Oh my God. No further questions.
Oh, all right, so have you guys been... I'm sure, I know Trina has. Renee, are you following Kanye West and his new wife?
Oh,
you see her, how she dresses all the time?
Okay, so as a Chicagoan, I have to give a disclaimer.
Yes.
I like the old Kanye, not the new Kanye.
Okay, well, fair enough. I love Kanye.
We love Kanye.
I accept Kanye with all his ridiculousness and everything.
Yes.
And we support Kanye. We are praying for Kanye.
Yes.
Kanye, if you hear this message, we are always supporting you. You are a son of Chicago.
Yeah, he is.
And we are here for you.
He is.
Call home, sir.
Call home. So
left the light on.
Have you seen him and his new wife walking around and she's like basically naked all the time? Are you up on this?
Wait, Bianca Censori.
She's basically naked. I thought she was always clothed like a...
Like a strip or something. Titties hanging. Everything's always see-through.
Okay, she's
walking around like that all the time.
Bianca.
And what I'm asking, I guess, is a couple questions here. One, is there any harm in it?
Yeah. First of all, he's a dad.
Okay.
He's got 2 daughters and he's got 2 sons.
Mm-hmm.
His new wife, I'm sorry, rewind. Let us not forget that Kim alluded to his controlling nature of her image.
Oh, nice. Okay, here we go.
Kim alluded to him controlling what she wore, the image that she portrayed.
She did do that, yes.
That he wanted final say on how she looked when she walked out the house.
Mm.
And it looks kind of more the same with Bianca.
Okay, that's a good point. That's a good point because the second point was, why do people instantly blame Kanye for her doing what she's doing?
Yeah.
I I have a different kind of view, and it's more of Kate. And it's going to sound a little harsh.
Go.
Just a little. Just a tiny. And I got to be careful how I say this. I feel like sometimes some people are aware and want the bag so bad that they're willing to accept mistreatment because they rather have the light of the status, the Birkins, the beautiful homes, the trips.
Paparazzi.
So they will sell their soul for material things.
And
so they rather be mistreated as a person so that they can feel some sort of status in life.
Mm.
So I was watching an article about Bianca, and I think she's from Australia. I might be wrong. Oh, jeez. Oh. But Bianca's mom came to visit her somewhere, and they were saying that when Bianca went out with her mom free of Kanye, she was dressed totally different.
I mean, yeah, that makes sense.
And so it led more to the
Kanye doing it.
That Kanye was in control of how she was looking when she goes out. I mean, like you said, you sign up for the bag, you sign up for the this and the that, and you give all your cultural, I mean, your creativity to him, an image. It's like he was trying to recreate a Kim and dress her in a manner that was very reminiscent in how he dressed Kim when she was walking around in, what was Kanye's
like Bizarro line? Kim Kardashian?
Yeah, Bizarro Kim Kardashian. I don't know, but remember how when Kanye came out with that lining of clothing that first came out, it looked like the end of days?
Yeah.
Walking Dead.
The end of days.
The end of days, walking the dead.
The zombie attire.
Oh, and remember they said the clear shoes were falling apart, the models, the shoes were falling apart on the runway and stuff, and it's just more of that. I mean, she's like, it's like a mix of Lady Gaga and Kim on the runway with Bianca, but I don't know. I mean, she signed up for it. I don't know if she's gonna give a tell all when they get divorced and say he made her do this, he made her do that. But
I also just want to make sure if she's a victim, you know, she's dealing with narcissistic behavior.
Yes,
that like she's getting the help she needs to escape her. If he's an abuser to her, you know, no one should go through any mistreatment in relationships.
I agree.
Absolutely. However, and I'm not putting a but statement in this, right? That's period. But I also want to make sure, as I just put a but, I just want to make sure too that, like, again, I don't want to say I know these people or their situation or their relationship. If you saw a man mistreating someone, and I don't want to go too far into conversations, but like there was a interview with another podcast where a doctor mentioned like women see men who mistreat women and then they want to come into a relationship and be like, well, I'm gonna change him,
he's not gonna be like that
different
with me.
I'm gonna make him like this because I want him. And it's like, no, girl. He gonna treat you the same way,
right?
Because that's how he is. So
is there a chance that she is a willing participant just doing what she wants to do?
Absolutely.
And there's that.
It is.
There could be
a check assigned to it.
Huh?
There could be a check assigned to it.
Or yeah. Well, I mean, clearly, if you're with him, you're married to him, then you're enjoying the money as well, right?
The money.
The benefits outweigh
the trips, the jet setting, the paparazzi. Maybe you're enjoying the attention of being snapped everywhere.
Yeah.
The restaurants, the appearances, the red carpets, all of those things. This could be a win-win, and maybe she's trying to advance her career, and hopefully she's trying to get into...
She don't want no more Cheesecake Factory.
Yeah.
Like, she's like, I'm over Cheesecake Factory. I want
the Cannes Film Festival. Okay? I want Sunday. I want the things. I want Mallorca.
She want to go to Utah.
So why isn't that usually the first go-to for people who see that scenario?
Well, that's what I said first.
Yeah.
Like, she's a willing participant?
I said she could be.
I mean, she signed, you know who you're getting with. And there's been a question of his wellness. And if he's unwell, and Kim was very clear on the Kardashian show that he was off of his meds, and he said that he's not taking the medication. However, he's been diagnosed with ... So her entering a relationship with him, listening to his own statements about his mental health.
I see what you're doing there. I see what you're doing there.
You see what I'm doing?
And I'm about to reset the cameras. So,
he on the pull your heel.
I like this. This is fun, y'all. This is fun. Really, yeah, this is really good. You enjoying it? I'm enjoying this. And my back is feeling better. Shout out to that.
Yeah. Oh, the stuff is working?
Yes, it's working.
Yay. The rosé is kicking in.
The rosé is kicking into.
Yay.
Been drinking champagne all morning.
Yay.
Have you ever had a person react negatively to your progression in life? Without saying too much.
Like you say,
no, I'm not trying to get too personal.
Oh, you're vegan now. You can't.
bigger than that.
Yeah.
You're also, bigger than that.
You're all spiritual now.
Whatever you're doing, whatever progress you've made in your lives that you thought a person will react one way, but they reacted a different way. Yeah. Yeah, Renee Casa. You understand what I'm talking about, Renee?
Oh, yeah.
You want to talk?
I got a macho man ready set. Oh, yeah.
Shout out to the macho man, Savage.
Oh, shit.
Yes, yes.
Back into a Slim Jim. Yeah. Sure have. Sure have. Yeah, I mean, from like even a dating perspective, I have, like in my career, advanced and had some accolades and like promotions, celebrations, and been like thought that like someone I was dating or been in a relationship would like help celebrate or be happy for me, and they got jealous. It was like a whole attitude, like where'd that come from? Right. And it was just because they weren't getting the same in their career. They didn't feel like they were being celebrated. They weren't moving in their career. They didn't feel aligned in their life. They weren't moving forward. And that's one of the craziest moments when you see it happen with someone. You're like, oh. Because you never want to be like in a friendship, relationship with someone where you see jealousy. Because like, there's nothing you could do when someone's jealous of you.
Yeah.
There's nothing you can ever do. Because that's evil. That's pure evil and hatred. And it's disguised as, oh, well, I wanted something for myself. And I just was overreact. Nah. That's because it's going to come back. Because anything good that happens to you, they will never be happy for you. They will never celebrate. And you can celebrate them, but they'll never be satisfied because they're always going to be in competition with you. Whereas you're looking at it as like, this is a competition. This is supposed to be a helping situation with each other. Like you're supposed to be amplifying it and sort of encouraging each other.
Right.
And that's never a good thing when you see that. Yeah, girl, let it out. Come on, let me take a sip.
Well, you know,
I would say that sometimes people pigeonhole you in a place that they want you to be in.
Ooh.
Damn. And when they see, and it can be family first, okay? And they see you have this growth and this happiness and you're receiving love and a new partner and a positivity and a healthiness and a growth and a flourishing of where you're moving with your relationship, and you get the feedback of, well, all you want to do is spend time with him, or why you want to just, you know, like there are a lot of, instead of just being happy for the fact that you maybe have found a partner that works with you, that you're happy with, that you're healthy with in a relationship, you could feel a lot of feedback from family that is otherwise from celebratory
about your
relationship. And it can be very off-putting because you're like, well, are you happy for me? Right. Do you want me to be? Do you want me to be in struggle? Do you want me to be in pain? Do you want me to be in the whole dudes ain't shit and this and that and all that kind of stuff? So sometimes
niggas ain't shit. Let's go ahead and say it right.
It could be family that can see your progression and you're flourishing in love and happiness and all these things, and you being really happy, and either they A, don't want to acknowledge it, B, don't want to congratulate and celebrate, or they can sit in jealousy.
Damn. That's a crazy
sad.
Thing.
That's sad.
And it just, those kind of things make me approach a lot of times family and non-family people the same way. Because that blood, you know what I'm saying, don't always, it don't always mean as much as people want to make it seem like it means. And then, of course, you know, we dealing with friends. I mean, I've had, you know, just us, based off of us getting married and stuff, I have friends that just started acting different. I'm like, why? I don't understand.
So you guys have had friends that have become jealous of your love.
I can't say that because I don't know what they, I can't read what's in them. I don't know. They know, only they know.
Well, actions, right? You can see their actions.
You can see people act different towards you.
Yeah. My assessment and whatnot would be on some occasions, jealousy. And then on other occasions, some people, I think that they just don't know how to act. It's just like whether you get married or whether you get a $50 million contract or whatever it is. Now they in their mind you're a different person and they don't know how to act with you, so therefore they back off or whatever whatever the case they back off.
They stop communicating
because in your mind you're the same person and you're moving the same.
And I'm happy, and I want you to share in my happiness.
Yeah,
but people may not talk to you anymore, not return your calls. Become distant.
Mm-hmm.
They become non-responsive. Which is also distance, and you're like, well, what happened?
And this is based off of you progressing in life in some way. So it says a lot, and it's a mystery. But at the end of the day, you just got to keep it moving. What Beans is doing something over there?
He's trying to come in with Willie.
Beans trying. Oh shit! His toy's down.
Yeah, come on.
I forgot to put his toys away.
You didn't put. He's trying to bring Willie in. Oh, don't move it! Don't move it! Don't move it! Because it's gonna mess up the scene. He'll get through. He knows how to do it. Oh God,
fucking Beans! He just cost me some editing. I gotta cut all this out.
I'm
sorry. No, I'm talking about Beans.
I would say that I have had some people who either A, don't talk to me anymore, or don't talk to me as much because I'm married. Now.
Right. So a second question then, that kind of related, but not at the same time. Friendships, outside of what we were just talking about, how should you approach your friendships? Do you manage your friendships? Like each individual, different types of, you know what this person requires, that person, so on and so forth. Or do you function better when friendships are on autopilot and you ain't got to worry about them?
I mean, I like the friendships where I don't have to, but you understand everyone is busy. Everyone has multiple things going on in their lives. They got a job. They got a side hustle. They got kids. They got kids in college. They got younger kids. They got a relationship. And you just know, okay, when we check in with each other, I right. give my undivided attention and we catch up and boom. Some people, it might be every 6 months. Some people, it might be monthly. You just kind of navigate based on what their lives and what's going on with them.
True.
Because I can't assume, because I see it on Instagram and I see it on Facebook, that everybody's okay.
Right.
Sometimes you got to make a phone call. You got to do a text. You got to do a voice.
Got to check in.
You got to be like, hey, how are you doing?
Yeah.
Are you good?
Yeah.
Because what you see on the socials might not actually be what's really going on. And I've seen people posting like, oh, I was just talking to this person and they were good and boom, they died.
Yep.
They died.
Yep.
You know, stuff like that.
Damn.
I manage, like there's certain people I have a list and I'm like, oh, I got to check in with her. What's going on with her?
Mm-hmm.
And I also do it in relation to kids and back to school and back to college and getting close to graduation and all those things. And just kind of checking in with people. You got to check in.
This year, I kind of made a decision. I might've mentioned this on a pod before, but I mentioned pulling the chair. I don't know if you remember that. So Beans is going crazy with this toy. Typically, I put these up when we shoot.
Yeah.
I forgot.
But Willie is good.
He's going down there going nuts.
He's with Willie.
But in basketball, like when you're down, the bucket is right behind you. Someone's backing you down trying to score a basket. As defense, if they're pushing too much pressure, you know that you got a rhythm, right? And at some point, you just back off, and then they'll grab the ball. They'll travel and ball.
Yeah,
pulling the chair from under. I pulled the chair from under a, a few friendships this year. Meaning, I realized that I was the only one ever making any type of effort to sustain this friendship, or even to just to make contact and say, hey, or anything. And I just stopped. I just stopped. And they just stayed right where they were. You know what I'm saying? I mean, have you ever had anything?
And I actually am going through that, like, right now, I think, myself. Like, I feel like there are some friend groups, some friendships where I'm just, and just people in general, I'm just like, I do too much work here. So, I'm chilling. You know what I mean? Like, if I didn't reach out, or I didn't ask for the drinks, or I didn't call and see how you're doing or text, how long would it be before you reached out? You know what I mean? And it's not like I'm checking for it, or it's like some sort of test. It's more of like, maybe our friendship is run its course for right now. And that's okay, right? Because right now, maybe in the circle of life, what you got going on is what you got going on. And again, if you shall pass, or if I should pass, or whatever, like, sorry, sad, but like, there's ebbs and flows and times, and you know, it, it happens.
Like, Renee, what you said is dope, like, right now.
Right now.
Because that means you're not closing the door on the friendship. It's just, right, you know what I'm saying? Whatever the right now is. Maybe later on.
Everything's good. Might be a year. Might be 6 months. Might be a couple weeks. But like right now, whatever you're going through, whatever I'm going through, whatever it is, like, it's just not where we need to be in speaking like that. Or I need to be checking in. Or I'm not thinking like, oh my God, they're mad at me. Or we're not really friends. Or we, life is life and for everybody. Everybody's going through something. I don't know. I may not have the capacity to check in and be a real friend for what you're going through either. I may not have the capacity, if I called you and asked you what you're going through, to handle what you're going through. So I probably shouldn't reach out. Because I might not be able to handle what you're going through.
Receive it right now.
So it might be a good idea for me to just slide the chair back.
I
understand that.
And when I am ready, hey, time will tell. I'll reach out, or you'll reach out. And we'll be able to reconvene. And, you know, if it's time is ready for it, we'll reconvene. But there's never any love loss. If it's true friendship, time doesn't really matter.
I agree with that. You know what? And I come from an only child section of the house, where people who grow up as only kids learn how to be their own friends and stay in their heads and stay with themselves, and friendships are here and there. I was the only child, but I had a lot of cousins. I had a lot of girl cousins that I grew up with. Because I was an only child, the cousins were always together. But sometimes my friendships or whatever, you just kind of, you manage them. And I think that also trickles out into my workflow, my work and the work that I do. It's, you know, something that I don't talk about. And that part of it also impacts how you function and how you relate and how you reach out. Guaranteed, most of my close friends don't know that I had a cardiac situation happen in the last 2 months. They don't know. Because it wasn't something that I felt like I wanted to drop on people and be like, hey, I was in a hospital, and it just wasn't something. I felt like that was cool. We were dealing with it. My kids knew, my immediate family knew, and it just wasn't something that I felt like I needed to parade around to other people. I didn't want a pity party. I didn't want any of that stuff. I wanted to get my shit together so that I could feel better. But it wasn't something that I felt like I wanted to dump on other people to have them worried and you know, all that kind of stuff. But you manage your friendships. You manage who you share and what you don't share. And people don't know what you're going through. And like I said, Instagram will, or Facebook or TikTok will look like all is well, where the whole house could be on fire. Behind the scenes. And you do not know it, because I'm forward presenting X, Y, and Z.
And the truth is, you don't have to do that. But the reality is the comfortability of where you are in life, right? In the space, and like what you were experiencing, was traumatic, right? And so like, who wants to sometimes go back and repeat the trauma of their experience several times over.
This person, that person.
Yep.
You don't want to do it because you're reliving it every time you talk about it.
Yep.
So it makes sense. And so sometimes when it comes to friendship, it's like you have to tell certain people because, again, you know, family, you know, you have to tell your children, you have to tell your mate, you know, because it makes sense, right? Because close proximity. But also, like, why do you want to continuously repeat it? Because you don't want to have that moment again and again and again. You want to get past it because you want to be healthy.
Yeah.
And also, too, who you, like you said, you don't want to feel like a burden because the friend that you are to others is they come to you usually
with their problems. Check on your strong friends.
Check on your strong friends. I have friends that I speak to every day, almost every day, right? You know, every other day or so. I have friends that I speak to, my boy Stud, I speak to about twice a year, once or twice a year. And every time we talk, it's as if we just saw each other. And we haven't seen each other since the 90s.
Wow.
And then my boy Dex, and like we don't talk, but we interact social media-wise. Mm-hmm. Whatever, he doesn't call me, I don't call him. He don't text me, I don't text him unless it's a specific reason. But when we see each other, complete love, everything is good. And I had to recognize those things because a lot of times I find myself wanting, putting a requirement on people to give me what I get. Like, I'm an over communicator. I talk a lot. You know what I mean? I reach out. I want to share my ideas with my friends because it's just a method that has worked for me through life. And then I'm expecting, well, I ain't heard from so-and-so. He don't hit me up. Well, you know what? Guess what? That's what that is. And once I got better at managing those friendships, I didn't worry about it anymore after that. Yeah. So, you know, it's good stuff, yo.
Yeah.
Good stuff.
And again, everybody handles friendships differently.
Yeah.
Everybody's going through life in different ways.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And experiencing life in the trauma, the impact, the highs, the lows, the ebbs and flows so differently. So, like, we just have to give grace where it's needed.
Shout out to that.
So that we're able to also give ourselves the grace that we need to be a good friend. Not only to others, but to ourselves.
Listen, y'all, I'm talking podcasting with black women, yo. You're going to hear about some grace. You're going to hear about some of these things.
Yes, we're a therapist at all times.
Oh, Trina got some. Her finger's up in the air. Go.
Go ahead. Come on, preach the gospel.
I got to go to the bathroom.
Me too.
Okay, go. Bathroom break. Everybody got their relief situation straightened out.
Listen, I feel so much better. My bladder was about to explode.
I am so glad you're like, you got to go to the bathroom. Because I was sitting over here like,
yo, it's all chill here. You got to go to the bathroom. Just let me know. Just let me know.
Because I was sitting here like, okay.
I was like,
yo, y'all hilarious.
I was like, this should be fucking drink champs. I was like, This is light.
We don't usually go too crazy on the show.
No, we don't.
But sometimes we'll have a nice little Manhattan on here. Ooh, you know what I'm saying? A little Negroni or something. Like, I almost poured myself some whiskey just now. Yeah, listen.
Sir,
had a massage.
Shout out to my Uncle Harry, who I told you will be drinking Uncle Jack Harry. Daniels at 9 o'clock in the morning to keep his back straight.
Sometimes
it's like that.
Yeah, you might need it.
Sometimes it's like that.
And notice his back is straight and yours ain't.
You know what I mean?
You might want to go on, listen man. To Uncle Harry. Cause
Uncle Harry got to figure it out.
Listen, that medication was medicating. Listen.
All right, so Cam Newton. And I'm about to leave the room. Cam Newton, what y'all got to say about Cam? Trina, I will let you take lead on this, please.
I can't get the time back that I spent watching a 2-hour interview.
I can't believe you watched
Dr. Cheyenne was her name. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Here's
why Cam Newton take the air out y'all?
Because
the air out the room too.
Okay, so there was I took a notes on high functioning versus high value men and high functioning women versus high value women versus low functioning women and this whole conversation. And shouts out to the doctor who came on the show, who I believe disarmed him with her beauty. She was probably a woman who he would normally try to holler at.
Yes.
Period. hard stop.
You think so?
Right there.
He was attracted to her.
He would try to holler.
He was at highly her. Attracted.
He to was her. Highly attracted to try to see if he could possibly.
You think he would have a chance?
And plant a baby. No, she has hard rules about what she will not. She will not date men who have children.
Yeah, okay.
Okay? Mm. She has rules. She's called off several weddings. She's called off a few. You know, he tried to dig into her. Why you not married? Why you don't have man? Why you, you know.
I saw that
he tried to do. What's he tried wrong to do,
with you? I watched about a 7-minute time. Clip to.
I watched 2 hours and 23 minutes that I can't get back in my life for Cam Newton's Funky Fridays. I
my scalp itch.
Don't even follow
this nigga Cam said her scalp itch.
Okay, I sat there. I had to stop it several times just to go back and turn it on because I was like.
Let's talk about the kids thing.
He got 8 kids. By 3 different women, one being Jazzy, the comedian who just had her baby. The doctor who was on his show was Dr. Cheyenne Bryant.
Okay.
She is from Los Angeles. She is an NAACP president. She is a PhD in psychology. She did the show. She was on a show.
Basketball Wives.
Basketball Wives, as well as Teen Mom. Mm-hmm. She was a Teen Mom thing. Her mission is to help the community, to give back. She comes from a broken home. She gives her background. Her mom and her dad were teenagers when they had her.
Okay.
14, damn, 14 and 16. Jeez. Her father is a former gangbanger.
This podcast is kind of professional. Go ahead.
Her father is a former gangbanger who went to prison. Okay. Her mother also was in the gangs and drug distribution and addicted to drugs, who has now been clean and manages her businesses.
Okay.
For her.
All right.
So she comes from a broken home. She's the oldest of 7 children. Her parents were not married, and she uses.
Before you go, what's let's define, because we're gonna need this later. Mm-hmm. A broken home. What's the definition of a broken home?
I think what she used it as was that her parents were not married.
Okay.
They had a kind of tumultuous relationship between the jail times and the separations, and that her grandparents came in and raised her.
So her dad was never home.
He was present, but there was a time he was incarcerated.
Oh, so let us define, cause this is for the discussion, yes, later, what a broken home is to us. What is a broken home? It's a broken home. Dad, mom, kid were together, and then one dad left or mom left, and you're with just dad or you're with just mom. Is that a broken home?
The definition.
Or never there.
Is the parents were never married.
They were never okay. Married. So.
And the father is not in the home. The mother is not in the home. Like, the parents are not
in the same home.
The same home.
Correct. So her parents.
Whether they were before or never.
Never.
Okay, gotcha. Never.
So her parents were together, however, never married, and were teen parents. And she's the oldest of the 7 children.
Understood.
Of the parents. She looks to her grandparents as the representation of a healthy,
okay,
you know, nucleus, yes, of a marriage. And she talked to him about
spreading the seed.
Behaviors.
Mm-hmm.
This whole question of high functioning versus high value versus low functioning versus low value. Kind of like with the cult leader. What's his name? Kevin Samuels used to talk about a high value man versus.
Did you just call Kevin Samuels a cult leader?
I did.
Don't act brand new because we got a company.
He is a cult leader. He is. He is a cult leader. He's a cult leader of misogyny.
Oh, Lord have mercy. We'll talk about this on another pod.
So she just talked about that with him. He gave his theories. He comes from a home where his mother and his father have been together for 30 plus years. Mm. He gave some statements that his mother gave about, are you willing to go to hell with a person? Like, you could be there for the love and this, but are you willing to go to hell for your partner? And I'm like, go to hell. Oh, okay. And she actually was like, oh, that's a great whatever. So just a lot of talk about that. She did disarm him. She did built him up before she broke him down. It's so you could
speak. You're giving a very biased take on this conversation so far.
Is it biased?
Yeah, because that's an opinion that she broke him down.
In my disarmed him. In my opinion.
Well, I will say that you. I think the take was she definitely she came from a professional stance the entire interview. Time. And she was disrespected by someone who wanted to act like they had a professional opinion when they did not. He wanted to come from the side of he was a colleague of hers.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, okay.
In the profession. And he does not, because he tried to go toe-to-toe with her with degrees. So he's like, he's like, I have a sociology degree as you're a doctor and you have a doctorate degree in psychology. Well, that's not equivalent.
That's not equivalent, Cam.
What was the basis of him saying that?
Just said that he, you know, he's got some schooling too.
That's what the basis was. Right. And so for someone to make diagnosis of someone, and she said, I did not diagnose you.
Yeah, she didn't. Yeah.
And so basically, to Trina's point, I think she's giving a fair assessment, mm-hmm. not an opinion.
Yeah.
I think the conversation was very alarming.
Mm-hmm.
Cam Newton was disrespectful, and it was really not an opinion that he was disrespectful.
Mm.
It was condescending in how he was speaking. She was very...
She handled it, though. Is that what she's saying?
I thought she handled it well. I think my thing with him is that...
She was professional in how she responded.
He came off... He kept joking about the gloves are off, the gloves are on, the gloves are sliding off. And for me, it was... He was never going to truly be serious about the conversation. And he looked at her because he talked about how she didn't have a Wikipedia page. That was the first one for me. I was like, dude, what are you talking about? She doesn't have a Wikipedia page. She's a doctor. She's a PhD. She has patients. Maybe she doesn't want to have a freaking Wikipedia because she's working.
Let me be clear. I can't take listening to Cam Newton for more than 3 minutes at a time.
Yeah.
He is a complete nincompoop.
Yeah.
All right. So listening to the little thing that I'm like, this dude's he's an idiot, but just trying to be objective and, you know what I'm saying, approaches.
So I feel like I don't know what his end game was or his end goal, but I think he was ready to go toe to toe with her, and she shut him down in a way that he couldn't really argue with her.
So let's get to the kids thing, right? Yeah. She's saying that he has 8 kids by 3 women.
Yes.
Right, and basically, what was the accusations that she was making against him about that? She was saying about it.
Well, I think there's even a bigger conversation, because what he was trying to say was he's fighting the issue that he's scared of divorce, so he's ready for children.
He's scared of divorce more than he desires being married or something like that.
Yet he just had a child with a woman that he's in a relationship with currently. Which is very scary, because if I am this woman,
it tells you he's not gonna marry your ass.
I am I'm just like
zero.
This lady who is you, I hope she, girl, you's in danger.
Run,
because this isn't gonna end well for you.
It might not end well if it goes against what she wants. If she's getting what she wants
she's
out of this.
She's not getting what she
and
wants.
And so what the doctor said about that was some of these women get into these situations for reasons. They get into it for a bag. They get into it for a lifestyle. Uh-huh. They get into it for a house or for whatever. She points that out during the interview, that you find these women and you have these situations with them because there's agreement. Because
it's a perfect match.
You're going to get something out of this.
Yeah, like,
this
everyone gets what they want out of this.
But, right. But she also went into a further statement and was like, for this age you're currently in.
Yes.
So you're 35 and it fits your narrative at 35.
Mm-hmm.
But you're not looking when you're 40, 50, 60, 70.
There's not a lot of people making decisions today with later years in mind. People don't do that. They making decisions based off of right now. People getting their faces tattooed, their necks tattooed. Listen, all these different things.
But when you're dating, right? And I, we can use you two as an example. You guys married as a union for better or worse for the future. That's why you two are
life.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Right. This is a, so when you guys are 65. And y'all are like, we are going to Florida. Which part are we going to? It's because you guys have already known that you guys like to do these
things. We're not going to the Atlantic Ocean side like you peasants. We're going to the Gulf. Relax. We're
you
not the same.
Saying, but like you guys, and that's what she was saying. And so what he couldn't comprehend was the fact that people should be looking for future ideologies. Not current self.
Like she said, I'm with that. Interview, I'm here for that. Like, what religion do you want your kids to be raised under? How do you feel about changing diapers?
He's not putting thought into all that shit. If I had to guess, he's not putting.
He's looking for a hot chick that he can impregnate.
Yeah.
And as he said, I have 8 children with 3 different women, and I want more.
Right.
But I don't want to make them whole.
Yes, with a marriage.
I don't want these kids to be whole.
Yeah. Mm. And then he said that the kids all live with him. And she said, so the mothers don't live in the house, but you have all the kids in the house. So that was never quantified. It was never.
So she did kind of come back and she gave examples and he's like, yeah. And then when they go with their moms.
Mm-hmm.
So I did catch that. So, no, they don't live 100% with him.
Right.
Because they go with their moms,
they go with
too,
their mothers, too.
Because he was like, they're not single mothers.
Right, because he does so much. But the first one was really pissed when they broke up because he put her out the house. The first mother has 4, I believe. The first mother has 4.
Because he was trying to marry her.
He and was. And they were engaged,
hurt.
Right?
He got hurt by her.
Yeah.
Which is why he's in the situation.
And he put her out.
He never got the therapy he needed.
He definitely is.
So this goes back to women creating monsters?
We could say that because women do create monsters just like men create monsters.
Yeah.
People create monsters. People create monsters because of relationships are whatever they are. People have experiences with people.
I just pray that the mirror is held up to him and he takes the time to get the therapy that he needs. Because going on these podcasts and spewing off your theories and
well, I think there's a deeper issue with his parents, and that's something that I was picking up. While I think he idolizes his parents,
yes,
there is some trauma that happened in his childhood, that there's something there with his parents.
Okay.
So let me ask you guys.
My parents wasn't married.
Based off of our definition, we both coming from broken homes. I'm not sure about you, Renee. But my son.
Oh, the kids.
My son, right? Yeah. So
broken. I don't have no babies. Broken. And if there's somebody out there that don't have babies that want to get to know me, we can talk.
There you go. Bing. Broken homes.
Yes.
Right. Extremely successful kids.
Extremely.
Right. So
thank God.
If his kids, let's say out of 8, because 8 is a big number.
8 is a lot.
Kids. Let's say 5 of them extremely successful. One of them kind of got us up together. The other 2, you got to throw them away.
Yeah.
Is that?
Yeah, throw the kids away.
throw them away.
Now you just did the numerological.
Is it all numbers? If we revisit this in 20 years, is it all water under the bridge? Because everything ended up well. Because my son, broken home, ended up perfectly fine. Like not perfectly fine. Pardon me. Everyone has issues, right? But he's doing great in life. Your kids doing extremely well in life.
But I
right?
talk to them about the traumas of divorce. I talk to them about the traumas of the things that they witnessed their mother go through and needing them to get counsel and therapy for what they don't know that they are, that's on the inside.
That's great and valuable, right? Well, people are saying to him, that you're creating these kids knowing you're not going to be in the home, right? Where that infrastructure, father, mother, child in the home is, some would argue, a dated approach to life. Like there's modern ways of doing things now. People are living on different coasts. People are having kids knowing they're not going to be in the same home and successfully raising kids together. So does he have an argument at all?
That he doesn't need to be there?
Yeah, that he's being a part of their lives in a way that he deems or they deem fit. because they know they're not going to be together. So does he have any ground to stand on there?
But he doesn't really know the impact until the kids none are
of us,
older.
None of us do.
I just think he's being reckless in the fact that he's continually going out here saying that you want marriage, but you're
he
afraid
doesn't
of
want
you.
Marriage.
He's
saying
no, that? No. So he does want marriage, but he's afraid of divorce, and his fear of divorce is so high, but he wants more kids.
That's true.
So he did say you're that. Being reckless yeah, like true. That, right? When yeah. you're being reckless in that sense. So I'm willing to continue putting more kids in situations where potentially, right,
yeah.
I'm setting you up for not a full household. I'm just right. just saying that, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Potentially. And I'm setting you up for, I don't know, the tip drill I met in the club tonight.
Tip drill.
You must be up because it ain't your face, right? I don't know.
The paper bag drill?
Hey, she got a big booty, must got to do the duty. I don't know. I'm just saying. So I just know that for what I understand for him, there are a lot of successful people who come from homes with not having both parents. I come from a family where I have both parents in the home.
Yeah, me
like
too.
I am grateful that I had both parents. I would not be who I am today without my parents being mm-hmm. there. It, they have definitely established, and I am the independent woman that I am today because I am dependent to, on them. So I am grateful for that. But I know there's other people who can't say that. And I look at some of my friends who are reflectively are like, man, I wish I had my dad that came to my volleyball games when we were in high school or whatever else. And like, I see the impact it had on them. And maybe their life would have been as difficult or their journeys would have been as difficult, right? Mm-hmm. So there are pieces that are there that may have been, made people's lives easier, yeah. right? So I can reflectively say that, right? That's what I think she was trying to convey to him. And I right. think that's the piece that's missing. There's going to be moments where your kids are like, I wish my dad was here, but he has to go there because he can't be where I am because of this situation. And I think that's what he was missing, because he made the choice to have kids willy-nilly.
Damn, that's great. And here's another point, right, to add. Typically, these stories, it's either someone, in my experience, these stories of all these kids with these different women, either someone extremely rich or someone extremely poor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right? So on the rich side, these people have already made a decision to sacrifice things to accomplish their goals.
Mm-hmm. Right.
They want to be superstars. They want to be football, basketball players. Yep. They want to be rappers, whatever they want to be. They realize that I have to cut off my friendships. I have to miss my kids' birthday parties. I have to do all these things. So the mindset is already there. And then this is just a natural progression almost. Am I off with that?
Nope.
Oh, that's right.
And so people like you, people like me, Renee, we're exceptional in our own rights. However, there's certain levels that we may never reach because I'm not willing to sacrifice my friends and my loved ones to accomplish them.
Right. There's a few friends I'm willing to sacrifice.
Well, yeah, no.
I will volunteer them as tribute.
No, thanks for keeping us grounded, Renee. I love that.
It's really true. Like, as a parent, especially if you are, say, me, I got divorced after 8 years of marriage. And I was the primary caregiver for the girls.
Mm-hmm.
And soccer and activities and all those things.
Saturday morning,
just sleeping in, just in general, became my responsibility. And I had to make sure that they had the stability that of the things that they like to do. And I couldn't rely on him. I had to be the one. Did that sacrifice? Did it make me change different ideas and career decisions? Absolutely.
Right.
Yeah.
It made me not move to Florida because a long time ago I was trying to go and I didn't because they needed to stay up here near their dad. There were things that you do. You sacrifice things for your kids for the greater good of their growth and flourishing.
You, yeah, sacrifice things for your kids. These cats sacrificing their kids for other goals.
And they think the money is able
the money
to
will give
take
it.
Care of it.
It'll yeah. take care of the private
I'm able
schools.
To pay for their school. I'm able for them to have a car. Right. They can go get whatever they want to get.
Yeah.
They're able to afford these things. But, like, yes, there are trade-offs. But I just think of every single parent or parent who are the primary caretakers or who are in their children's life. And it's like, I think of my best friend and, like, I told you guys the story at brunch, you know, my best friend, shout out Melinda again. She just dropped her daughter off at Alcorn, right? Mm-hmm. And like all the things she had to go through. And I just saw how stressed out she was to drive from Chicago to Alcorn and mm-hmm. renting a car and buying all this stuff for a dorm. Her daughter also is playing at Alcorn on the women's basketball team and like setting all that up and preparing her for classes. Like the work you guys do and sacrifice, like, is so much and so like, I could tear up. Like, it's so dedicated to another person's success for their life, right? That you're sacrificing your own success and your own goals and aspirations.
Yes.
You put them to the side.
Yes.
For someone else.
Yes.
And that's just commendable, right? Like.
Yeah, it's an interesting thing. I appreciate that. Thank you for that. You know what I'm saying? It's an interesting thing because we have these kids. With what you said, we have these kids who know who they are, right? These kids know, I don't want to work a 9-to-5. I don't want to commute. I don't have to do that. I can pursue my passion. I don't need this job. I don't, right? I want to do what I want to do, right? Yeah. So they get down the line and how are they affected and their kids after that. Like, it's just a wild chain of events.
Definitely. Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It is the zigzag, the break in the continuum. What is it? The Marvel? What was it?
I like show? The break in the continuum. The that was pretty good. Continuum. Shit.
It is, because it sprints off the the lines go off in this direction and that direction, and it's very different. It's very.
I just want y'all to congratulate yourselves. Like, I think y'all parents, again, you know me, I'm all about grace and like congratulating and celebrating yourselves. Like, as parents and all the work you guys have done, like, y'all have done so much to make great human beings. Like, as you said, like, y'all have survived divorce, but you guys have also come together and created a blended family that's so amazing with great kids, right?
So
y'all have great kids together, right? Celebrate yourselves. Like,
it's funny because they have been together, sort of kind of together. They kind of like talk, you know, together.
What's that?
When Kennedy, when all of them were together.
Oh, yeah, no doubt.
They had their talks and stuff together.
Yeah, appreciate that, Renee.
But thank you. Thank you. Listen, it's a process.
It's a responsibility that comes along with it. Like, the way I look at it,
yeah.
Like, I fought. You know, my son's mom and I, clearly we didn't stay together, right? And my whole goal from that moment on was make sure I had my son. I was in his life as much as possible, which was only 50% of the time. I wasn't trying to get 51 because he needs his mom as well. You know what I mean? Yeah. So if, you know, based on her, if she had characteristics that made me think she needs less than 50% of the time, then I would have went after that. But that wasn't the case. And that was it. So I fought from that from the beginning. You know what I'm saying? And the conditioning. Shout out to my son's mom. You know what I'm saying? We went through a lot and stuff, and we in a good space now. It's great.
Right. Growth,
at
y'all.
At that time, the concept of a man wanting to be in his son's life more, in her mind, in my opinion,
it's foreign.
It was foreign. It was like I was taking time away from her. And I'm like, whoa, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Only one person can hold the child at a time. Like, mm-hmm. It's like, it's 50-50. This is what we got to do because we're not together. That's all I wanted. So I couldn't imagine creating kids in this world that I couldn't spend time with.
Yeah.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And there's no podcast, there's no Whiskey and Kicks, there's no Where's Brun, there's nothing creatively or personally that I would want to accomplish that would make me sacrifice being in his life as much as possible. Mm-hmm. So you'll never see me on being a rapper. You'll never see me being a superstar. You'll never see me because I'll never sacrifice my friends and my family mm-hmm. and loved ones for money.
And ultimately, the kids see it all.
They see it all.
And they make their determinations accordingly as they become adults. They take the synopsis of what they've experienced over their lifespans, and they make their determinations about their parents on their own.
The kids know when y'all humping. They 3 years old, 4 years old, 5 years old. They know when y'all really humping. They be knowing.
They be knowing.
They be knowing.
They be.
Yes.
And they will tell you later on down the line, a couple of years, like, remember when, Oh, yes.
And when you leave your kids at home, when they probably get hit that age, when you can go out and leave them, they going through your shit.
Oh, they going through your stuff. They tell you everything.
These is all good things to know.
I went through my parents' shit.
I don't remember what I did. I'm the youngest of three, so like I was just like, I'm just here for the pizza. Like,
I don't know. I have a group chat with my daughters. They reveal so much to me.
Are you serious?
Oh, yes.
I'm still afraid of my parents. I'm terrified of them.
Yeah, oh, girl. What? Oh, yes. They tell you.
If you let me a quick question. We got like 1 minute.
Okay. Yes.
If your kids move back to the area,
what?
How often do you think you would see them?
Like every day.
You think so?
I think that they're
going. Mom, what are you cooking today? Mom, what you cooking?
Oh, shoot.
We would be like, y'all gotta go.
Yo, shout out to Jordan.
Because you know they would be in here asking for food.
Oh, hilarious, yo.
I love y'all. I love y'all.
I don't know if Taj, I don't know how often I would see Taj. I think Taj would still be doing his own thing, but yeah. I would see him more than I do now since he's in Brooklyn. But that I think I agree with you. I wanted to ask her that question because I knew.
We got two kids in Brooklyn.
Oh, wow.
The girl and the boy. Jordan's in Brooklyn. Taj is in Brooklyn. And Kennedy's in Blacksburg.
Yep.
But let me tell you, if Kennedy want to know where we moving next,
so she can follow us.
I love it.
Yep.
Wait, what's going on with Halle Berry?
Okay, so, ladies and gentlemen, the Black woman delegation would like to extend support and love to Halle Berry as her former husband continues to argue for custody of shared son Maceo and request attorney's fees to be paid, to request support in all measures, and he's also requesting custody, while Holly has since requested that an emergency order be put in place so that she can have complete custody to make determinations for his education and for his psychological treatment and needs, because this battle that they've been going through for several years now has maybe traumatized the kid a bit.
Is this the one with Eric Benet?
This is the same. Nah.
No. She didn't have any kids with Eric Benet.
She had
a kid with Martin Olivier.
Oh.
Yes. So she had a son with Olivier, and then she had Nala's dad, who she also is still paying child support to because he ain't got no job. And remember, the two, they beat each other. They had a fight.
She paying child support to two different men?
She's paying child support to Nala's dad because they split time with Nala, the older daughter.
I've never seen Halle Berry with her kids before.
She doesn't like her children to be photographed.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Respect, and then Maceo, the son with Martinez, Olivier Martinez, he is like, she's abusing her power as a Hollywood superstar.
This is what the father is saying
that she's abusing the system, that she's putting this emergency injunction in place. He can't afford to fight her in court because she's a $1 million actress and she has a new movie coming out and she has more money and he can't afford, so he needs her to pay his attorney fees.
This is why you got a date in your bracket,
girl.
Honey.
Date
in your bracket.
Stop dating down.
City boys up.
Ladies, please stop. Stop dating down, okay? Actresses, stop dating down.
J-Lo dated a dancer.
And he got paid.
And look what happened.
Chris Judd got a check.
Shout out to Chris Judd. City boys up.
And you ain't seen him
since.
You ain't seen him since.
Hey, Renee, that passion for dancing went out the window, didn't it?
Out the window.
He has been sitting down.
So Halle is in court again with yet another father to her children trying to get money, get custody, and argue with her over her celebrity in using that so that she can afford some sort of relief.
If you do not have what I can lose to lose,
oh,
I don't want to be with you.
I can't be with you.
This is what they doing out there.
If you can't lose what I can lose,
fellas, y'all listen to this.
Stop falling in love with these actors on set, okay?
If you cleaning the bathroom on the set,
yes,
I'm not going to come talk to
don't
you.
Don't procreate with this man.
Well, maybe she wanted him to make her feel good.
Then that's the problem.
No, you going you can make me feel good by cleaning that bathroom. Keep it going, girl. Job.
This man is angry, and he is.
What was he? What is his profession? Is
he's an actor as well.
He's an actor as well.
He's like a C-level actor. He's a
C-level. Well, from what we've been hearing the last couple years, like 95% of the industry is C-level actors. None of them getting money.
She make more money.
But she's getting checks.
She's Halle Berry, man. She's Halle Berry. Yeah,
listen.
And so they're fighting over custody of the son. He wants to live in Europe with the son. Holly's in L.A. She wants to have him near her. She wants to pay for his schooling and his psychiatric treatment because he has been traumatized by said experiences with parents and all the back and forth.
Is this dating your bracket stuff the reason why Megan Good would let me come upstairs in their apartment in New York City?
Yes. You
were not in her bracket. Because I wasn't in her bracket.
You were not in her bracket. You were not in her bracket. I love you, honey, but you were not in her bracket.
Damn. Okay? So it's like that.
Decatur is not Atlanta.
Yeah. So we really, I need us to support Holly and lift her up, and judges and all the legal folks.
Keep her lifted up.
Keep her lifted up in prayer.
Where's my MLK church fan?
Lift her up in prayer because we are tired of Holly going through the bullshit with these baby daddies or ex-husbands or whatever they are.
Her edges are still laid. Let us continue to pray.
The Black Women Delegation has Holly in their prayers on the sick and shut in list. We want her to.
I love Halle Berry, so I'm with y'all on that. I'm just making jokes. I love Halle Berry. I mean, City Boy's up. It is what it is. I have my allegiances.
Madness. This is complete madness because the money she's paying out to Nala's father is ridiculous.
She got
to
make another movie.
She got to keep making movies to pay that.
They said Kanye paying the most child support in U.S. history.
That's what you get. You wanted to marry
But it's crazy rich people taking other rich people to court for child support.
You got four kids by this dude.
You got a child named Chicago.
And North and Psalm and Saint.
If Kanye West sends Kim $800,000, let's just say 800, 200, let's say 200, the number was,
not enough.
How does that apply to the kids? What is Kim going to do? She can't even see that. They can 200K can show up in her account without her noticing.
That's pocket watching.
Okay. It sure is.
That is popular.
It sure is.
Listen, these kids,
if that money did not show up in her account,
exactly,
we would notice.
She would notice.
Children have been afforded a certain lifestyle, and Kanye needs to pay for it.
You think that Kim Kardashian can't give those kids the lifestyle that they're accustomed to?
It's not about Kim Kardashian.
So Kanye's not supposed to play any part
in it? Of course. What I'm saying is the child support is not needed for him to play his part if he's a good dad, which he seems to be.
With the child support just ensures.
Yeah, it's just
It doesn't ensure anything.
It ensures
you're going to get money and ensure some kind of bitterness somewhere along the line.
Some niggas
need it.
Now Kim and Kanye were arguing over more. They were arguing over where the kids were going to school. They were arguing over that type of stuff. He didn't want North on social media.
To go
media.
To the Hollywood school.
He didn't want North on social media. He had some specific
visitation.
Thing.
Visitation.
He had some specific things that he was arguing with Kim. Knowing where they lived. All that kind of stuff that he was arguing with her about. Mm-hmm. Which I think is important because I think that there was a time that North was too young to be on socials.
Okay. Understood.
I think she should.
And how she was on socials.
And also the Kardashian compound and being on these shows and all that stuff. I think some of that these kids don't need.
It's not real life.
At a certain age, they don't need it. And let me just tell you that Chicago West is gorgeous, and she's gonna be the sleeper. She gonna be the one. She gonna be the one. Chicago is gonna be the one.
North is pretty dope though.
North is dope, but Chicago.
I feel like the other piece that and I gotta give Kanye some credit. He's like, these are black girls. These are black children.
Mm-hmm.
These are black children.
You ain't gonna raise them.
I need them to understand their blackness.
They're black, yes.
And I think the Kardashians, unfortunately, are not doing them a good service.
I got a theory on that.
With a lot of their children. And I noticed I said Kardashians because all of the grandbabies are black. Except for Courtney's.
Trina X about to speak.
So, I will now pass the microphone to.
I'm sorry, Renee.
The leader known as Trina Black. X. Mohammed.
All they've been doing is having baby by Black people.
Here we go.
Okay. All they've been doing is exploiting cultural appropriation, all these kind of things. And what is this going to do for these brown babies
they like the brothers,
that they have now produced?
They
okay.
Like the
because they really can't speak to Blackness. They can speak to Calabasas.
No, yes. Yeah, those kids are gone. I mean, they're rich. So the money takes them out of that all you know, automatically unless someone's making an intentional effort to neutralize that.
Well, and also, well, like, there's an ad, I don't know if you guys saw recently, where they're, like, showing their Armenian culture, right?
Girl, bye.
And
Whoa.
This whole selective Armenian-ness that they have.
You think so?
Selective.
I mean, it's
well,
it's
and
hard.
Also the census data says Armenian is white, so they're
white. Yeah, they're white.
It is what it is.
Yeah, just like another selective group that likes to come out sometimes.
Trina X is in full effect, yo. I'm not arguing with her. I gotta live with her.
And there you have it, ladies.
We live together.
Trina X, Mohammed.
She set me up. All right, so let me give y'all a story real quick.
Okay, give
then we're
gonna
pass it to y'all to share
okay.
experiences.
Okay, okay.
This is first date experiences.
Oh, first date.
I'm the only single one here, so how are we doing this?
This is a flashback. Believe it or not, we had lives before we met each other.
We sure did.
We don't want to.
I don't believe it.
Somehow,
I don't believe it.
We only 4 years in.
Back in the day, I met someone on one of those dating apps. Right, boom.
One of
here are those photos. Right, ooh. See the photos. All right, cool. We're gonna go forward with this. We talking, chopping it up for a while. Decide to finally go on a date. Mm-hmm. Right, I go to the bar, waiting for her to get there.
Which bar?
She's like, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. There's trauma attached to this.
Trauma.
We don't want to talk about the bar.
Okay.
We go to I go to the bar. Wait for her to come in. This is about to be bad, y'all. Just letting y'all know.
Okay.
She's like. All right, I'm getting out of my Uber now. I'm like, cool. I look, walking through the door is a paraplegic chick.
Wait.
It was her.
No, she's not walking if she's paraplegic.
Coming through the door.
She's in a wheelchair? She didn't tell you?
She's paraplegic.
Wait.
She couldn't even pick up her. She couldn't even hold her own drink. Like, she was like, her photos. Look, you would not be able to tell. She said nothing about that in her profile. She said nothing about that as we spoke.
Wait,
notice
what?
How quiet we both. I was like, I'm trying to just.
I'm not making this up. This is a true story.
She's a paraplegic. Wait, she walk in a. She came
listen,
in a wheelchair.
Man. Listen, man.
She
listen.
Came in a wheelchair.
No. She was disabled. She was
okay.
She had a hard time getting from point A to B. She couldn't go up and down stairs. She could not. She couldn't hold her own drink up. She had those issues going on. She was disabled, and she didn't tell me she was. This was a first date. So I had to sit through this and make eye contact with bartenders who knew what I was going through.
I'm just going to look down.
What did you say to
I
her?
I sat through it.
What did you say
I'm
to
I'm a
her?
Nice guy. I'm not a bad. I'm a nice guy.
No. So you didn't say you're not. How come you didn't tell me you was paraplegic?
I didn't. All I did at the end of it, I went my way. She went hers. And I deleted every
oh my god
piece of evidence that we even ever interacted in life.
Oh my
so my
gosh.
Question to you two
wow.
is what was your craziest first date?
No, we have to story. Dive into this real quick. I have questions.
Why you want to dig my trauma, yeah?
Because you brought this up. You can't drop stuff like even oh Beans got God. Questions.
Support black men, yo. Support
Beans,
black men.
Look at Beans. Beans is like, word?
Support
He's
black
like,
men.
You wouldn't even tell us this story.
Support black men. Hashtag.
Oh my gosh.
So. Do you want to take first bit, dibs?
Like, you want to ask him questions about it?
I got.
Oh, you can if you want to.
For it, because I ain't got no questions at this point. I'm like, listen.
It was horrible.
So, like, okay, she rolled through, right?
Rolled through. This is taking us to the top. This is it. Go.
I mean no disrespect.
Take Where's Brunch so to the rolled, top right
she,
now.
She rolled through.
Yeah.
And you're like, I, I see your face. But that's her.
This is this like. And so can you come up? Can you move to the right? Because I'm expecting someone.
And so she come
up. Looking past her.
So she come up. Mm-hmm. And she's like, hey. And you're like, hey.
Yep. It was pretty much like that.
Wow.
And she just like.
She act like nothing. She act like it was nothing. Like we had talked about it for hours before. We had never spoken about it.
And she's just like, oh, I'm so excited to be here. And you're like.
How you doing?
Yo, that's horrible. That's hilarious.
I'm sorry.
I never thought that I was going to have to beep Trina out on this podcast, but we might be there right now.
I don't know why I just screamed. I literally screamed.
Yo, this is crazy. I told y'all in the beginning. I told y'all.
Okay, so. I got two more questions.
Go.
And then we'll move on. I have a tear coming out my eye. Oh my God.
It's hot in here.
Oh my God. You like, okay, so I'm here. You here.
In my mind? Because my mind,
I gotta go.
It was two conversations going on at the same time.
I gotta go.
I was talking to her, and now in my mind, I was having a conversation.
So you were like,
one drink. We only got one drink. So the bartender was like, y'all go, nope, we good. Wrap it up, B.
You were, when you ordered the drink, you also passed in your credit card at the same time. And then you ran out.
Close us out.
Did you run out?
Close us out.
He was like,
I didn't run out.
You were like, do you want fries? We don't even need no snacks.
Went outside. She got to her Uber. Mm-hmm. And once she drove up, I was just like, it was one of those look in the mirror moments. Like, I gotta do something different.
What was the conversation like to get you to be like?
I don't remember. That was blackout. I don't remember the conversation.
Wow, that's deep.
I remember the beginning. I remember the end, and that was it. Wow. I don't remember any of the conversation that we had. I wasn't there.
You wasn't there.
No, I wasn't.
So what made you say yes to the
date? That's where I want to go.
She didn't show any of that. She had in the profile picture, she had a pretty face.
I mean, what about her personality things? And we y'all talked. Communicated?
Yes.
And you were on the phone to talk to her?
She was deceitful.
Oh.
Clearly, she was deceitful.
So you had talked on the phone or FaceTime or something?
Nah, no. Nope.
Wow. Nope. See, that's where you got.
Niggas on FaceTime.
You wouldn't even talk on the phone.
Niggas on FaceTime. Nobody talks on the phone.
I FaceTime.
You better FaceTime.
I know. This Trina is the FaceTime queen.
When we started talking,
FaceTime every day. I'm like, listen.
I need to know what you look like. I need to know all the things.
How are we going to FaceTime and really listen to each other having a conversation with all these strippers over here? They dancing.
What?
We have an inside joke.
I can't with you.
You know, Trina working the office once. Trina working the office once a week. That's when the strippers show up.
My entire body was like, I think this is another moment where we freeze the cameras. No, like,
y'all so goofy, yo.
Okay.
Y'all have any first
I have. I don't know. It came out of the seat. I have a first date.
Don't put it on the ground.
I don't know what it was. So I have a first date situation. when I was in Florida, I was on the dating apps because I wasn't meeting anyone down there. Like, I was just like, it was dry. It's very dry. And I'm cute, body, I'm going on the beach, I'm tan. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I met this guy on an app. I don't remember which app it was, but he was really, really cool. We connected. He was like a school teacher. And we met up at the bar at one of the hotels that faces the ocean. Great time. Good time. We had dinner, all that kind of stuff. And we're talking and blah, 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 blah. And we had communicated probably for that week.
Okay.
And I was like, oh, kind of feel him. He's kind of, he was Caucasian.
Oh.
Hey, listen. Oh.
Come on, blue eyes.
Hey, for the record, the person, mine was too.
Okay, I don't discriminate.
Yep.
Okay, I didn't discriminate. I'm United Nations over here. Come on. Okay, so. At the end of the day, we were trying to figure out, like, okay, where we're going to go next or whatever. We're going to hang out. We're going to do something else. Because, like Florida is like beachy, bar-y, or hotel. So And he's like, you know, I just, you know, I'm really digging the vibe here. I'm really enjoying, you know, our connection and John all this B. stuff.
John B.
And he was just, and he was really cool. Like he had his hand on my back of my, you ooh, know, your back lower head, back. On my lower oh. back. And you know, I'm kind of skinny and tan, and I've been at the beach.
Point,
and
I'm going to find this nigga. Then.
And
well, he's not that.
And, and then he told me that he had herpes.
Hard stop.
I'm sorry, my body, my soul just jumped out.
And he said he didn't want to be, you know, like he didn't want to be.
He wanted to be up front.
He wanted to be up
front. He wanted to be our friend.
That he was like, just in case, I'm going to take you home tonight.
Now, he said that he's usually on a different site where it has. You herpy can push people. Your. Yeah, apparently there's a herpes site that I didn't know about.
Do and you he have
was
herpes?
Like, no. And so I was like.
No, no, that's what he was like.
Right. And so he was like, said, you know, he's normally on another site and that it shows that he's positive on a site. So he just wanted to let me know that, you know, if I was interested in moving any further with him, you know, that I could go to the doctor and I could get something.
He should have put
so
on
that
his.
I can't.
If he's going to go to a non-herpes dating site.
Exactly.
He should put in his profile that he has herpes.
Exactly. Exactly. So I was just wow. like, it was a great date. When I tell you, we were having a good time.
Shit, probably was all right.
We were salsa dancing.
It wasn't that good.
You would have never met Trina.
Salsa
that nigga didn't have herpes.
We were having a good time. He had like this great house by the beach. He had a little coin. Okay, he had a little coin.
Listen,
women love that.
Listen,
y'all love that.
I'm telling you, sir. You,
and it was just like a.
If he did it, if he didn't have the hurt.
If he didn't have the hurt, we might not have ever met.
The day ended.
This if guy he didn't have the hurt.
What did you. Wait ended. A minute. Wait a minute. The day when ended. He said, when he let you know, what did you say in return?
I was just like, I'm sorry, what? That was the first. I remember you, I was like, I'm sorry, what?
Did you think, did we share a drink? Did I drink after I him like, or anything
I didn't
like that?
Did I chase his drink tonight?
Like, we didn't kiss. I was like, okay, we didn't kiss. We didn't everything. But he was just like, I just want to be upfront with you. And I was like, I'm sorry, what? What did you say? What?
That's upside. That's not upfront, bro. Upfront was on the app.
It was at the end of the
you should let me know a long
date.
Time ago.
It was the end of the date where we were trying to figure out what we were going to do next.
Oh,
and so clearly.
You know what he wanted to do next.
Okay.
If you see these dogs in your front yard.
Okay. You know, the tatas were up. The tatas were up. I was tanned. I was in a skimpy dress and all the things.
And he had his hand on your lumbar.
He had his hand on my lower back situation. He could dance. He could do a little, you know.
No.
Yeah. That's why he got the hurt.
Yeah, and so. And
that's why he got
and
the
I
hurt.
And I was like, I appreciate you being upfront with me, and I thank you for.
You're nice. See, nice for Renee.
I respect you for respecting my safety. First of all, because people lie.
Yeah, people do lie,
People lie.
People lie.
And I was like, thank you for that. You know, I'm going to go home.
And, I'm going to go this way. And you go that way.
And then that was the end. We talked the next day, and I was just like, yeah, I'm not prepared for this. I'm not prepared for this. I got to be honest with you. I'm not prepared for this, and I wish you the best.
Damn.
Really nice guy. Really great guy, but
your boat's not big enough for me, dog.
Yeah, no.
Jesus Christ.
Not enough for the herp.
You might have beat me. I think you beat me. Your story is crazier than mine.
Yeah, the herp.
The herp, man.
Right at the end of a great date, after salsa dancing.
Renee, what you got?
What you got? What's your bet? What's your birthday?
I actually never been on a dating app.
Oh, wow.
Really?
Never done it.
Any crazy first dates, period, though?
Let me go through this Rolodex.
Come on.
If you got to go through the Rolodex through all those stories, then you ain't got one.
You
got
that I want to share.
Yo, it's a crazy thing. Like, man, that is insane.
Yeah.
That's insane.
Uh-huh. Yep.
Okay, so I did go on a date with a guy years ago. I'll tell my Caucasian gentleman story.
Okay. Right. And you looked at Trina in judgment, but she said that gentleman was Caucasian.
No, I didn't feel no judgment.
It was never a judgment. We all had one Caucasian gentleman. And to my Caucasian gentlemen that are single, that are no children, who would like to date a chocolate diva, please.
Lawyers or better.
same financial bracket. please feel free to DM the Rosie R podcast.
We have fancy friends, y'all.
Please. It was weird. He worked in a similar profession as I. And we met on the hill. Probably saying too much right there.
Okay.
And he was like, yeah, we should go out. We should go out. We should go out. I was like, okay, I'll give it a chance. And we went out. We went to a restaurant on 14th Street.
Okay.
And I thought, okay, you know, this is an interesting vibe. And it was like a hood little, like, reggae. It was called, like, the Red Lounge or something like that back in the day.
So it's up top, like, over by U Street, maybe?
Yeah, yeah. Okay. And I'd never been there before. And I was like, how did this white boy know about this?
Is he down with the brown?
Then all of a sudden, I realized that. And he walks in and everybody's like, hey! And I was like, how everybody know you? He's like, oh, this is my spot. Like, I
look your bum bum down?
And I was like, what?
What was his name? What was the reggae dude name? Look your bum bum down. And bum. You want to date with a former?
No.
Can you get bum bum down?
What was his name?
Snow?
Snow.
And bomber.
I hate you both. But like, for real, like, his whole, like, white boy, like, exit was gone. Like, it was like this New Yorker from
Bronx
attitude. Like, I was like, who is you? And he's just like, yeah, you know what I'm saying? All I was like, and then he was like telling me, like, yeah, you know, I'm a Mason. I was made. And I was like, I'm so sorry.
He was one person on the beginning of the date and another person at the end of the date?
No, wow. Like how I knew him.
Oh, okay, gotcha. Okay.
And then when we got to the date, I was like, who is this person?
That's a Steve Harvey.
Your ass gonna be on YouTube. Renee, your ass gonna be on YouTube.
Where's this come from? What? It was wild. And I just was like, I'm not sure who I'm here with tonight, and I'm not feeling very safe. I'm
not feeling very safe.
I felt like a white woman, and I was like, I'm gonna go home. And I text like three of my friends. I'm like, my man has me feeling very nervous right now.
Oh my god,
and I'm here with a whole bunch of black people, and I feel very, very unsafe. And I just was like, can somebody just meet me, like, follow me in my Uber ride?
Let me find out he code switched and you code switched.
Oh my god, I was like, I gotta get out of here. And that was the wildest. Like, and like the next day at work, he was like, hey, how are you? And I was like,
he had his white voice back on.
He was back to white boy Brad.
Lord have Brad. Oh, Kyle. Oh, yes, Kyle. Oh, shit. We are done here.
Today. Shout out to Kyle on the hill.
Shout out to Kyle on the hill, baby. It's enough of those.
Look at her face.
Renee is gone. I can't wait to clip this up. This is fantastic. We are not talking about what we watch. We're done with that. This is it. Yeah, this is it. This is perfect, y'all. Until part two, we are out of here.
I cannot.
That's it. We out, yo.
That was gold.